Good evening. Hello, this is Ben Jones, and welcome to the Virgin Radio Live Lounge. The Virgin Radio Zoo Sunday Night Live is very proud to welcome a true talent.
And a virgin.
A lovely lady and a multi-million selling artist. This is Sheryl Crow, everybody. We will chat with Sheryl in a mo. First, though, some live music. You can start. This is Every Day's a Winding
live.
Road. Awesome stuff. Sunday Night Live, live from the Virgin Radio Live Lounge, the Virgin Radio Zoo. Sheryl Crow is back at Virgin Radio. Good to see you.
Ben, good to see you. you?
Looking very well.
And you?
Listen,
as well.
Last week was the Grammy Awards, okay?
It was indeed.
And I was doing a little bit of research about you. You got nine.
I thought you were going to say you were in a little bit of rehab.
Well, we'll get to that a little later. 9 Grammy Awards you've got. Is that right?
It's true. A girl can't have too many Grammys. That's
give,
what
give
I
her a round
say.
Of applause. 9 Grammy Awards, everybody. Where do you keep your Grammy Awards?
I keep them under lock and key. No, that's actually not true. I have them up in my library so I can walk by and go, huh.
Have you ever actually lost one?
No, but actually I thought I'd lost 2 and then I forgot that I had, during my drunken years, given one to my manager and one to my parents.
So you've never lost one though?
No, I haven't.
Because I kind of imagined you'd actually have them on a mantelpiece, but then the awards that you've won, that would be quite a long, 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 long mantelpiece.
You have to keep adding on to your house.
There's a lot of stuff.
No, it's fun. I mean, that's the coolest thing. The Grammys are really where it's at. And, you know, when you win a Grammy, it's in our business, it's like the Oscars. So it's very, very, a very sweet moment.
9 Grammy Awards, everybody. So listen, a lot of people here, a lot of TV cameras, which is kind of crazy for a radio show, but hi, TV cameras. And a lot of Sheryl Crow fans here as well.
You stuck them in the kitchen.
Good evening, Sheryl Crow fans. And a lot of hangers-on from Virgin Radio.
Make me a cappuccino, quick.
Bizarrely come in on a Sunday evening. So we've got questions from them, and I got questions as well, and a lot of live music, plus new stuff from the album Detours, which we love, by the way.
I think you're asking a lot of me today. Do I get paid for this?
A lot of money. We have a suitcase downstairs.
Fantastic.
Envelope full of cash. So let's go back to 1994. All I Wanna Do comes out, and suddenly, you are everywhere. I mean, did that kind of surprise you, the success? I mean, could anything actually prepare you for the kind of success you had so quickly in 1994?
Well, it didn't feel like it was so quickly, because by the time the Grammys rolled around, which was where our success really, I think, leapt from, we'd already been out on the road for about 1.5 years, and I was sorely ready to make a new record. And then All I Want to Do won Record of the Year, and so that sort of catapulted us back out onto the road, and we were out for another year. So by the time I got to go in and make the self-titled record, I was just chomping at the bit. And we were lucky because it wasn't like what it is now where you're on a TV show and you're immediately famous and you have about 2 records and then no one knows what happened to you. And so this was like the day of you go out, you play for 10 people, and then maybe the next night you might play for 15 people until finally you're playing for 200 people. And, you know, we grew real grassroots and got the opportunity to develop as an artist, or at least I got to develop as an artist. And it's nice to look back through my career and see that I've gotten to be better as an artist and as a songwriter. Whereas today it's, you know, you got one shot, you got 30 million people that go out and buy your first record, and that's it. Although I wouldn't mind having 30 million people go out and buy my record, but, you know, it's different now.
Do you miss those smaller, more intimate shows, though? I mean, you play some big stadiums, and you play all the big shows, all the big festivals.
No, we mix it up. We've been really lucky. We've gotten to go out in the summer and play some really big places, and we've opened up for the Stones and played for stadiums, that's the biggest I'll ever know. Well, and also we've played places like Rock and Rio, where it's like 300,000 people. And then, you know, for this record, before we do any touring, we're doing some club dates, like the little Scala gig, and we played a couple of nights at a club in New York, and we're getting ready to play in L.A., and so it's fun. We get to do all kinds of different things.
Which gigs do you get more nervous at, the little ones?
Oh, these. This like one these. Right here at Virgin Radio.
I'm kind of nervous tonight as well. I'm kind of nervous. We're live on the radio, and the songs are all good. We're going to get something brand new. Now,
yes,
what we're going to get? We're going to get the new song,
Shine
Over Babylon.
Shine Over Babylon.
Tell us a little bit about this before you play it.
Well, it's about a girl and her pet octopus, and
I want to hear that song
later. This song is really, it's just about where we are collectively in our lives, and particularly in the United States, how much chaos there is, and actually, I think worldwide right now, we're all experiencing a lot of chaos, and hopefully it's a battle cry meant to incite some sort of movement of change.
A reality check.
Exactly.
Let's hear it.
Okay. I walk the heat of 7 hills, endless talk of losing wills, great highways in a constant melt, men and women and children all have overbuilt. Hands are all around. Clowns and gypsies all be gone.
You make me wanna shine over Babylon.
You make me wanna
shine over Babylon. You make me wanna
Is there a better way to spend Sunday night than in the company of Sheryl Crow, everybody?
Could be debated. Really could.
No, it's not. The answer is no, there is no better way to spend Sunday night. Good evening. If you just tuned in, this is Ben Jones live from the Virgin Radio Live Lounge, the Virgin Radio Zoo with Sunday Night Live. And this is Sheryl Crow. Plenty of live music from the new album and some of your old favourites to come as well. Before we get on talking about the new stuff and what you're doing now with Detours, let's keep it retrospective for a little. For a little while. Most people, I think, know that you have toured in the past with Michael Jackson. And I don't want to talk about the guy because I don't think anyone really knows what the guy is actually like. But to tour with Michael, to duet with Michael, that must...
I just can't stop loving you.
That was a song you did, yeah?
Baby.
That must be quite some buzz. It's quite some buzz to tour with a guy who, at the time, was just a musical icon.
He still has musical icon. I mean, you can't discount the guy because he's, you know, when you go all the way back to the early beginnings, he's 4 and 5 years old and he's singing Frank Sinatra tunes. He was definitely an important figure in American music and the architect, I think, of pop music in his generation. And also to stand on the side of the stage and witness a guy who's doing dance moves that no one had ever seen before and that look like they defy gravity. People have to remember how important it is that there are people out there who create things that have never been seen or thought of before. That's what artistry is. It's what genius is. I mean, that's really, I think, what defines genius is somebody who can create something that no one has ever dreamt of before. And so aside from all of his, you know, his personal dealings or goings-ons, musically, he's still important and way up there in my mind.
And what do you remember from that bad tour, those crazy days of the bad tour?
Well, you know, there were a lot of things personally for me. I didn't even own a passport when I went on that tour, so I'd never been out of my own country. I'd been to Mexico, that's not true. But, you know, it was a real life-changing event for me because, you know, I got to see things in the world that I didn't ever think I would ever see, and nor did I ever think I'd see them again. So I went to every museum, saw every statue, every important painting. It was like I was on a college course. And then at night I got to go play for 70,000 people. And so that aspect of it was really life-changing. But the thing that I remember most, and it is a moment that I take with me from that tour, standing on the side of the stage and doubling him on and just watching him sing that and remembering how deeply moved I was. I mean, he's one of those people that can really warm the molecules. You know, you're watching him, you're listening to him, and something happens, and I won't ever forget that.
It's, I guess, like touring with Elvis, I suppose, in terms of sort of icon ability.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely.
The other thing I wanted to ask you is something we've been talking about on the show the last few weeks, is we are campaigning for Muse, a British band called Muse, to do the theme tune to the next James Bond movie, Quantum mm-hmm. of Solace, just because we think it's a perfect
okay,
kind of fit.
That's a hard title.
Quantum of Solace. It's odd.
Quantum of Solace.
That's a lyric.
Quantum of Solace.
Kind of difficult to get that into a song.
That's tricky.
You did, was it Tomorrow Never Dies?
Yeah, that was tricky.
In 1997, which you got a Grammy nomination for.
Tomorrow Never Dies. I don't know, did I?
You did.
Oh.
I know.
Huh. Did I win?
I don't think you won, but you got the nomination.
Damn it.
So fair play to you for that. But how does a Bond theme tune actually come about? Do you get approached?
They give you a title. They don't let you read the script, and they don't even show you any footage. And basically, we all know what the Bond movie, what that legacy is, and the franchise and all. And I think Pierce Brosnan was the Bond. He was a great Bond. Yeah. I love Daniel Craig, though. But they basically give you a title, and you do what you do, but you can't help but kind of overlap into that kitsch world. It gives you carte blanche to just completely go out there.
Is it the hardest song you've ever written?
No, actually, it was really fun because of that. You know, it's like you get the liberty of doing something that is so completely out of your domain that you know you're not going to get criticized for it. People aren't going to go, oh gosh, look, she's totally changed directions. It's a Bond theme. So you get to kind of just become this dramatic torch singer. At least for me, that was what ours was.
So we're punting Muse to do the theme tune, but I think the tabloids in this country are after Amy Winehouse.
Of course they are.
Do you think that would be a good call?
Maybe. Yeah, maybe. I mean, could be great, you know. Could be great.
I'm kind of surprised, and correct me if I'm wrong, because I'm obviously not American or spent a lot of time there, but five...
It's okay, we forgive you.
Thank you. Five Grammy Awards she won last week. I mean, that's a hell of a lot for one little British girl, and she's tiny, by the way. I mean,
she's probably got somebody to help her carry all
Beehive
those.
Makes her look a little taller, obviously, but five Grammy nominations. Is she that big? Is she that well-regarded in America?
I'm a poor person to ask about that. I mean, I know the one song, and I think the one song was very popular, particularly because... a lot of our popular young people are in rehab as well. And so, in fact, I'm thinking about going because it looks like loads of fun, and I know my career will benefit from it, but I don't know. I mean, I think she's huge, yeah. And I think, you know, I got to be honest, I was here and didn't watch the Grammys, and so, but congratulations to her, you know.
Listen, we're going to take a break, and when we come back, brace yourselves, because this lot, the Sheryl Crow fans, have questions for you.
The ones in the kitchen. That scares me. That just downright scares me.
We'll take a few minutes to prepare yourselves and hose them down, and we'll be back with more live music from Sheryl Crow in a minute. All right, good evening. If you just tuned in, this is Ben Jones live from the world-famous Virgin Radio Live Lounge, the Virgin Radio Zoo, and Sheryl Crow is here, and Sheryl Crow is here with band. Please introduce the aforementioned band.
Well, to my left is Tom Jones. You might remember him from the 60s. Very popular. no, this is Tim Smith, playing bass, guitar, singing. Also did my hair today and my makeup. He's fantastic.
Round of applause, please, for Tim, everybody.
Thanks, everyone.
Peter Stroud to my right, and he plays guitar, leads, and also sings. And he's just an all-around good guy, vegetarian, surfs, and used to be a woman.
Round of applause, please.
And on the drums we have Jeremy Stacy. Don't you hate it when Americans act like they're English? Yeah. And he's actually English.
Hello.
Say something in that English thing you do.
What do you mean?
Oh, there you go. See? There it is.
Hello.
Hello, I'm Jeremy Stacy.
Dick Van Dyke-esque. Round of applause, please, for our friend on percussion. Right, we're gonna get some more live music in a second. A song we all love, particularly this chap here. Hello, Mark.
Hello.
How are you?
Very well, thank you.
Come far?
Collierswood.
No. So the answer is no. You haven't come very far. So this is a song that you would like to dedicate to someone very important to you. Just a few days after Valentine's Day, did you get her a card?
Yes.
Good. Did she like it?
Very much so.
But you're gonna do this because this is gonna get you a few brownie points, yeah?
Hopefully, yes.
Okay. So who's the dedication for?
This is for Amanda, my girlfriend.
Well, this better get you laid, okay? That's all I got to say.
It's guaranteed, my friend. Guaranteed, Mark. This is for Amanda, and it's if it makes you happy, yeah?
Yes.
Is there a message for Amanda? I'm not asking you to propose on the radio. Is there a message for her?
Enjoy the song.
There you go.
Okay.
Old romantic. If it makes you happy,
all right. Mark
Sheryl Crow.
And Amanda, here we go. 1, 2, 3.
Wow. How good do these songs sound live in the Virgin Radio Live Lounge, the Virgin Radio Zoo? Don't forget, if you want to see Sheryl live in Hyde Park, this is a good gig. This summer, you're going to be doing Hard Rock Calling.
Yeah.
With Slowhand, the legend that is Eric Clapton. I've never seen.
Clapton is God.
Eric live before. Is he as good as
You've
I hope he is?
You've never seen him live?
I've never seen him live before.
I want you to lay down that microphone. I want you to go home and dig out all of the vintage footage you can find of him.
I've got the autobiography. Fantastic. The autobiography is very, very good. I've just been reading that. And the Ronnie Wood autobiography.
He's wonderful. That's good. You need to go see him live. You will not be disappointed.
You're quite friendly with a lot of these guys. Eric's a good friend of yours. And we actually did an interview just a few days ago with a friend of yours as well. Is the clip ready? Because I asked this particular person to ask a question to
this
you.
This is your life.
So it doesn't actually say, the person doesn't say who it is, but I think you better hear it in your ears. Dean, do you want to play the question?
Where's Pookie?
Oh, my gosh.
Okay, so firstly, for those people in here who couldn't hear that, the question was, where's Pookie?
Where's Pookie?
Do you know who that person is?
Oh, absolutely. Don Henley.
It is Don Henley.
Yeah.
And what the hell is he talking about?
Well, I after the Jackson tour, I was Don Henley's backup singer on the road. And Don is a very close friend and also was a mentor to me in so many ways and has always been a person I can count on for total honesty. In fact, I'll tell you a funny story. Anyway, he called me Pookie. I don't know where it came from, but he's always called me Pookie. And I turned 46 just like a few days ago, and I'm still Pookie. So I appreciate that about him. But I'll tell you a funny story. I won Best New Artist Grammy. Did Amy Winehouse win Best New Artist?
She got a load. Best
yeah,
song.
Yeah, I have to assume that she won it. So, yep. And the tradition of Best New Artist is usually they win Best New Artist and then they're never heard of again. And so the day after I won, he wrote me a letter. Back in the day of faxes, there was no email. It came over my fax machine. It said, "Dear Pookie, congratulations on winning Best New Artist. Here are a list of those who have won it in the past." And then he puts, "Good luck." And it was like Jody Watley, Starland Vocal Band, all these bands you'd never even heard of after their one-hit wonder. So.
You gotta love Don Henley. Amazing voice as well. When I did the
Fantastic.
Interview and he came over, we did an ISDN interview with him, and he came over. This voice is just incredible. This Texas drawl thing that he's got. A legend as well. Listen, I got a question here from a fan. Sheryl, please meet Roland. Roland, hello.
Hello, Ben. Hello, Sheryl.
Hello, Roland.
What is your question, Roland, for the lovely Sheryl Crow?
My question is, who would you most like to collaborate with and why?
Oh, gosh, that is so hard. I've been so lucky that when I first came out, I was embraced by a lot of people that I just absolutely admired, from Eric and the Rolling Stones and Bob Dylan, Stevie Nicks and Amy Lou Harris, a lot of people I had grown up just really loving and admiring and still do love and admire. And so I've been lucky that I've gotten to work with a lot of people. I would say that it would be great to work with any one of them again. As far as my peers, I mean, there's so many great, young, exciting people out there now, from Feist to Alicia Keys. And so anybody who's out there who's excited about music, for me, would be interesting to work with. But I always love collaborating with, you know, Emmylou Harris and Stevie Nicks and, of course, the Rolling Stones. That didn't really answer your question, did it, Roland?
It kind of teases. It's a bit like an episode of Lost. You've kind of given us a little bit, but there's still plenty more to come.
Okay, I want to collaborate with Amy Winehouse because she's really hot and cool right now.
That's what the PR team are after. They can run and sell out to the newspapers now. Thank you. Listen, let's get some more live music. Okay. What are you going to do now for us?
We're going to do the title track of the record called Detours.
Love this.
Mother, can you hold me together? Find some took my first breath. I can't stop looking back for the answers. I just keep coming up with regret. 'Cause there are some things I just can't forget.
Sunday Night Live from the Virgin Radio Live Lounge, the Virgin Radio Zoo. That is the title track to the current album, Detours, which we like, and it's getting a lot of critics saying good things about this album.
I love the critics.
Critics are great, aren't they, when they say nice things, and they're shits when they say bad things. It's a very socially conscious album, particularly in a world, in a music environment now, where we get songs about umbrellas and songs about souped-up Bentleys. It's an album about you getting things off your chest, isn't it, really?
Yes, indeed. It is. It's interesting, because the last three, four years have been... informative years for me as far as my own personal life is concerned. I went through breast cancer treatment and had a very public split, and really up until that moment had just been on this crazy breakneck pace of working, and had kind of let that define me. And I think one of the things that the breast cancer diagnosis did was make me stop. It just halted me in my tracks and made me address my own life, and it also taught me how to really hold an emotion as opposed to doing what we Westerners have perfected. Which is just distracting ourselves, you know, that old idea of, listen, I know you're really down, just try to stay busy, just keep busy, keep doing, you know, just keep busy. And that whole idea of not really facing what you're going through and distracting yourself with busyness is what keeps you from ever really growing as a person. It keeps you from living your life, really living it and being in your life. And it also keeps you from drawing the things to you that your life is missing. For instance, if you're lonely and you distract yourself from being lonely, you're not going to fill that loneliness void. You're going to fill it with distractions. And we've gotten really good at that with tabloids and emailing and certainly 24-hour TV, all the news and reality TV shows. And I think not only in my personal life have I gone on some detours away from who I thought I was going to be, but in America in the last 7 years, we've definitely been taken on a crazy detour so far away from what our nation was meant to be and who we perceive ourselves to be. And so that's really dictating at this moment in time that we address where we've gone and how to get back to where it is that we need to be.
So was writing this album then, was it cathartic for you?
I think that idea of catharsis is getting rid of or shedding or like what you said, getting it off your chest. And to me, this record was much more about waking up, because I don't think you can ever really get rid of the experiences that continue to inform you about who you are. And obviously, all of our countries, England, the United States, all of us are going to go through transformations. This particular transformation that we're going through in America is a very dark place because we have gone to sleep. We have perfected this numb ourselves out or fold when there's too much for us to actually really deal with. We've lost our belief that we have any say in our own government. We've lost the belief that we can change anything by virtue of the fact that we've been told that. We've been led on a campaign of fear that has dumbed us or dulled us out to the point completely being comatized. So, you know, this record was much more, much less about a catharsis and much more about waking up and the idea of how exhilarating, frighteningly exhilarating it is to be awake and how much of a burden that is, but facing the burden of that.
Do you think the audience, people like me and the guys here, actually care what musicians think about in terms of their politics? Bruce Springsteen, Michael Stipe, yourself, are all very vocal in, we kind of know which way you're going to vote come November, which is not a problem. And for me, I like that kind of thing. But do you think the main audience is a mass, really give a damn? They just want a good song.
I think less and less. And I think part of it is that we, you know, it's one thing to be a public figure and go out and lead the fray of how you should vote and how you should think. But then you line it up with the way people, all these celebrities, you line it up with how we see them in the magazines and how they live, and it doesn't add up. And it's, you know, it's difficult to believe in anybody anymore when you see people at their absolute worst. And the magazines all capitalize on that. That's how they make their money. And one of the interesting things that happened for me when I was going through breast cancer is that I had never been an A celebrity as far as the tabloids were concerned. I was never hounded or run down by paparazzi until I got diagnosed and my relationship fell apart. And I thought, how interesting that that's what's going to sell these magazines is me at my lowest. And that's what we are. Why it is that we're craving that right now, I don't know. Maybe it makes us feel better about our own lives. But yeah, it's difficult for us to really care about how a celebrity's going to vote when we see them at their worst. So I think it's a consciousness. We really have to go inward and really examine who we are at the deepest, most personal level to find out what we believe in again. And we've got to figure out where art fits into that, because art typically throughout our lives, throughout our history, throughout our humanity has been what has cataloged us throughout our history. It's what has marked us throughout history. It's important, and it ought to be respected and revered, and yet we've gotten away from that. We feel like it should be free, and that people who make music, it's not a craft. It's not somebody's calling. It's something that should be that can be shoplifted, and that there is nothing that's important that needs to be said. And I find that to be sad, because I figure, throughout history, I've been able to look at a piece of art and know who those people were, or listen to a song, or read a book, or read a poem, and know something about that generation of people. And we're not going to have anything like that. We're going to have a bunch of contest winners and people in rehab. And
it's
so on.
It's kind of sad. 2008, obviously, a big year for American politics. You are essentially voting on the leader of the Western world, or mm-hmm. the free world. Here we are thousands of miles away, and actually, really, we don't care, although we probably should care, because, as I say, you're voting on the leader of the free world. Mm-hmm. Bush, clearly, it's good to see the back of him, and you've been making some big enemies at the White House in the last few years, particularly in environmental issues. Who is there, then, to save the world?
Well, I think above and beyond all of the partisan politics, it's just exciting in America to finally see a woman having a very good chance at becoming president. In every other country, we've seen women in the highest positions, and not in America. And we're supposed to be the most progressive country, and so far we've really not backed women. And so it's wonderful to see a woman, and it's equally as wonderful to see a black man. And so whether you're a Republican or a Democrat, how hopeful for every kid in America, a black kid, to know he can maybe be president, or a young girl that maybe she can be president. And so for me, there's a lot of hope in that. Clearly, I'm a liberal, and so I believe that this election represents hope and it represents change. And I'm seeing a shift in America that I believe is truly representative, that people are starting to wake up and feel their power again. And and hopefully this will dictate that we start holding our political figures responsible. You know, no more government contracts for a few people to make millions of dollars on a war that's based on a bunch of lies. You know, that's not going to happen again. And if it does happen again, we're all in very big trouble. And the environment, this idea that it's cyclical is denial. And our politicians should have been leaders in the fray, and yet they've convinced all of us that it's cyclical, and that it's not scientific proof. So, you know, I think people are slowly waking up, because they're having to. It's difficult to deny that the environment is in trouble, that the planet is suffering, and when you have weather systems like what we're seeing, and when you read about species going extinct, a third of all species, that offends me. That makes me mad, because I have a young kid, and I don't want to explain to my kid what a polar bear looked like, you know, what that
it's
was.
It's frightening, actually.
It is. So, you know, slowly people are waking up, and hopefully, instead of falling back into this denial state of numbness, they're going to wake up and feel their own power and know that we're on the precipice of being able to do something. We're going to miss our opportunity, though.
So. Wow. We got quite deep there, didn't we? Which is quite deep for me. I'm normally very sort of fluffy and very thick, but that was my audition.
And this is why I do so well at pop radio.
That was my audition at Radio 4. I think I did all right. Listen, wait there. We're going to be back with more live music.
That's all going to be edited out anyway, Ben?
That's Stan in. I'm anti-Bush as much as you are. Round of applause. We'll go to a break. We'll come back with more from Sheryl Crow and Mo.
Let's go to the bar.
Live on Virgin Radio. This is Ben Jones. Back with some slightly fluffy subject matter now.
Yeah.
Dave, come over here. Dave, how are you?
Oh, mate, fine, thank you.
Where have you come from?
I've come from Coventry.
Bloody hell, that's a trek.
No, 1 hour, 9 minutes on the Virgin train.
All right, that's
wow.
A
wow.
No,
that nice was plug for yeah. Virgin. I'm a Virgin too. I'm plugging Virgin.
Okay.
Virgin all the way. Support the Virgin, I say. So listen, Dave, what's your question for Sheryl Crow?
Hi, my partner Sarah is a teacher. Would you go back to your original career as a teacher?
Oh, wow. Well, I have to tell you, I loved teaching. And when I left teaching to go pursue my wild and wacky dream of becoming a recording artist, I used to dream about it a lot. I would dream I was back in the classroom. And after I sort of, so to speak, made it, I went back and visited my school. And I loved teaching, you know, and I felt like it was a really honorable degree. And I think I was a good teacher. I really wanted to be a great teacher. But I had this other thing that I really wanted to pursue. But I think it's the most honorable profession. And I think it's, there's a wonderful writer here from England, and I can't remember his name. I'll have to do some research on that and post it on my website. But he's written a book on creativity, and he said, if you want to know what our future looks like, visit a kindergarten class. And I love that idea. So, yeah, I think it outside of doing what I'm doing now, that would be the place I would feel home at again.
When you quit being a teacher to be a music artist, what did your friends and family say to you? Because you were taking a punt. You were taking a punt at something that a lot of people don't really achieve, sadly.
Yeah, you know, it is kind of weird. I went home on a Tuesday and said, I told my parents, I said, I want to move to L.A. and I want to see if I can do, you know. I know, and they said, well, when will you be leaving? I said, Sunday. And that's kind of how much time they had to think about it. So, but I've always had a lot of support. I've always had people around me who said that you can do anything that you want to do, and that is the great American dream, you know, and that's the great dream of every kid. But we've prided ourselves on saying in America that every kid has the opportunity to do exactly what they dream of. And I happen to be one of those people that just was naive enough to think that there's nothing that could stop me.
Let's get some more live music, something from Tuesday Night Music Club, something we haven't heard for a while. Okay. Tell us a little bit about Strong Enough, for those of us that can remember it.
This is kind of a song about PMS.
Brilliant. This is for my wife.
Oh. Let's do that again. My hands are jet-lagged, too.
Gotta feel like hell tonight, and tears of rage I cannot fight. I'd be the last to help you understand. Are you strong enough to be my man? My
Nice to hear that again. Strong Enough from Tuesday Night Music Club. Does that album seem like a hell of a long time ago?
Seems like, you know, 2 decades ago, and then it also seems like yesterday. So it's, you know, time's funny that way.
Is it nice to hear those songs again, to play those songs again? When one of those old songs comes on the radio, can you enjoy listening?
There are a few I really enjoy listening to. One of them is My Favorite Mistake, and Strong Enough is one of them, definitely. There are other ones I just can't bear.
Really?
Yeah.
Name them.
No, I wouldn't do that, because then it sticks in your mind.
I suppose it's like having a favorite child as well. You've actually really got to pretend
that
you like them all.
I have this one child that I just can't stand.
Yeah. eBay. That's what it's there for. Listen, for those of us that have thoroughly enjoyed the live music tonight, and I think all of us have, round of applause, please, for Sheryl Crow.
You have to wake those people in the kitchen up. They're like, ooh, she's long-winded.
Fire up the cappuccino machine again. The only UK show that I'm aware of is Hard Rock Calling in the summer. Please come back and do some more.
We will, for sure.
When? For the love of God, Sheryl,
okay,
when?
All right, we're going to just stay. What the heck?
Do a residency.
Actually, I would love to do that.
I tell you, I can see you doing Shepherd's Bush Empire for, like, you know, weeks. It'd be packed out.
We love that place. We've had a really fun history there. We opened up for the Stones there, and we've done our own gigs there. We've filmed there. Eric Clapton played with us there. Ronnie Wood played with us there, and we just have a wonderful, wonderful little bank of memories from that place. So that'd be fun. Maybe we'll come back and cohabitate there.
Everybody loves Sheryl Crow. And listen, we appreciate your time and the band's time. We're so looking forward to Hard Rock Calling as well and whatever comes after that. Gareth, we got a little treat for you because you said it was your birthday earlier this week. Bring in the strippers.
The what?
Strippers.
Fantastic.
It's just a little bunch of flat. Go on.
He was giving it to you, Ben.
There you go, a little
beautiful.
Bunch of flowers
thank
just to
you.
Say happy birthday.
Thank you, Gareth.
And thank you for your time.
Lovely. Oh, they smell great. Smell them.
Works well on the radio.
Smelling the flowers.
Let's get one more song. And this is the current single, Love Is Free, which we love, from Detours.
Thank you.
Tell us a little bit about this song before you play it.
It's about a girl and her pet octopus, that's what I say.
I challenge you to write a song about a girl with a pet octopus for the next album.
That would be tricky. But no, this song is about New Orleans, and I think it was pretty widely covered all over the world how our administration dropped the ball on these people. And I made my second record down there, so I have a very strong connection to the city and a great affinity for the people down there. They have this incredible history of being soulful people, musical people, hearts wide open people. I mean, on any given day, they're having a parade about something, and so when this happened to them, just to watch their amazing strength to pull themselves through it. So many people have moved back, and when you go down there and see how very little has changed, it just breaks your heart. So it's really just about keeping these people in our consciousness and remembering who they are and celebrating their great stoicism.
Has the city fully recovered? Is it back to normal?
No. I mean, you go down to the Ninth Ward, which for you guys who've never been there, it was the probably the lower income housing, but these people had lived there for generation after generation, and I think a great deal of the soul of that city was in the Ninth Ward, and that was the lowest point in the city, and very little of it's been built back, and so much of the money that was allocated for that area went missing, and people went on holiday.
I saw a film that I think Ridley Scott directed it, and it was with Denzel Washington, and it was shot. It was the first film to be shot in New Orleans after Hurricane Katrina.
Yes.
And when you see this scene of this city devastated, what's even more terrifying when you watch that film is that you know that's not been put up by some set designer.
No.
That is how they found it.
Yeah, and we're a very rich nation, and we know better. You know, we shame on us. So it's going to turn itself around. But and there's a great documentary by, I think it's Jonathan Demme or maybe his brother, about New Orleans, and so you know it's definitely, you know, any little thing that can be done down there. I mean, thank God for Brad Pitt. You know, people slag off celebrity, but that guy is down there single-handedly getting homes built. So, you know, and they're incredible volunteers from all over America. These young kids are going down there and taking shifts building back homes. So it's, and Tim went down there and did a Habitat for Humanity. So there's things to be done.
Round of applause for Tim, everybody.
Yes. Tim, you're so cool.
And roll on November, I say. Listen, good to see you.
Here we go.
And this is Love Is Free from Sheryl Crow, everybody.
1, 2, 3.